come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as the deep cries out to heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as the deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus. Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we song, Jesus, we love. the orphans now have a home. All that was lost has found its place in you. You lift our weary head. You make us strong. Song, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Our hearts adore. Our hearts adore. Our hearts adore. Our hearts adore. Our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion. Our hearts adore. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Thank you. Mayong gabi sa tanan. Good evening, everyone, and good morning also to those who are worshiping with us from the other side of the globe. We also greet those who are joining us tonight, our church members here in the country and those who are living abroad, our dear students, faculty, and staff of Silliman University, UCCP members from other local churches here in the country and around the world, Silliman alumni from all over the world, our prayer warriors who are consistently praying with us nightly in our daily prayer meditation, families, friends, and friends of friends, welcome to Silliman University's University Church Midweek Service tonight on this third Wednesday of the month. We continue to observe Epiphany season, and tonight, as we can still feel that love is in the air, having celebrated Valentine's Day last Monday. And with that, our theme for tonight's worship is focused on the love that is demonstrated to us by God and on how we should respond to this love from God. I will be tonight's preacher, reflecting on the passage on Peter and Jesus' conversation from the Gospel of John. With me also as our liturgists and ministers are the rest of the pastoral team, Reverend January Alpuerto and Reverend Wella De Rosas. Our thanks also to our pianist, Ms. Alan De Adam Quesad Jovita, for tonight's music and for accompanying us in our hymn singing. And of course, to our technical team, for their continued assistance in all of our online worship services and ministries. Our thanks to all of you. For our announcements, part of our worship service tonight is the offering and blessing of the Bibles to be given to our communicants batch 2020 and 2021. There will be a virtual confirmation tomorrow at 7 p.m. via Zoom with 16 confirmants. They will be virtually presented this Sunday, February 20, during our worship service as we also observe Membership Sunday. Our endless thanks to all of you for your continued support to the church through your prayers and monetary offering. For those who want to send your offering, please refer to the details now flashed on the screen. Our gentle reminder to please send us a copy or picture of your deposit transactions for easy tracking and proper documentation. Once again, thank you so much. We continue to invite everyone to join our daily prayer meditation and be part of our prayer warriors every 6 o'clock in the evening, except Wednesdays and Sundays. For the rest of the announcement, please browse our parish news uploaded on our FB page for you to be informed. Thank you so much. Once again, good evening. Let us now continue worshiping God together.
Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God.
We are each a child of God, no matter who we are or where we are on life's journey, we are blessed.
Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled.
We come to worship the God who feeds us, who fills us, and who blesses us.
Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh.
Let us rejoice in the love of God. And worship our God together in prayer, song, and praise.
For those who are able, please rise for the hymn of worship.
Let us pray. Merciful God, you are righteous and love justice. Steer the hearts of your people, that rejoicing in our diversity, we may repent of the wrongs of the past, and by your grace, seek the peaceable kingdom of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us now humbly come to the act of confession. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Let us therefore come before God and confess to him our sinfulness in silence.
God is the potter, we are the clay. When we are cracked and broken, God helps to bring us back together. Sometimes we do not feel the same afterwards, but God uses every piece and offers us the newness of life to begin again. We are loved and forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Because it's clear.
Let us now unite our heart and spirit as we come to God in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord our God, on this middle of the week, we are once again gathered with your people in this space through a virtual manner. We worship and praise you despite the distance and spaces, for we believe that nothing can separate us from you. We are confident, dear Lord, that your spirit of love fills in the distance between us, connecting our hearts and minds, uniting our spirit towards a certain goal, and that is to praise and glorify your holy name. O Lord, as we focus tonight's worship on how we reciprocate our love for you, may you make us worthy to faithfully affirm and declare your love to others, just as you have loved us, especially in the midst of what we are going through right now. O Lord, in this time when we are all trapped with our own feelings of fear and anxiety, enable us to be an inspiration to everyone. Let our lives be living declaration of your self-sacrificial love for us all, as we also spread and manifest our love for you, not only during this time of crisis, but all through our life. O Lord, tonight we continue to call upon your name to save us from our fears, from our anxieties and worries for the future, and for the safety of our loved ones. Save us, O God, from the selfish tendency of thinking only of ourselves and not of the welfare and good of the greater community where we belong. Forgive us, O Lord, for our many self-centered ways, but enable us to reinforce the spirit of goodness, caring for others, and love for our neighbor, in the same way Jesus Christ has demonstrated his own life and ministry. May the example of Jesus' humility in his own ministry, in the way he dealt with the least of our brethren, in the way he gave them hope and a vision of a better life in your kingdom that he had proclaimed to them, and the kind of courage he demonstrated in facing his own tormentors and persecutors, be for us a source also of renewal and empowerment to carry on with our witness and service to your people, even in the midst of the growing crisis of our time. May you enable us, O Lord, to continue working as witnesses to your love as we try our best to pray for each other, support each other, especially those who are risking their lives in serving as frontliners in our continued fight against COVID-19. O Lord, for those who are inflicted with the virus, and even those who are suffering from other sickness, those who are confined in the hospitals, those who are stricken with terminal illness that render them hopeless, we lift them all before you as we pray for complete healing and full recovery. May they experience restoration that can come only from you. Restoration for both body, mind, and spirit, leading them towards a renewed life as they witness your transforming and healing power to everyone. Lord our God, you are our peace, even in this much troubled, ailing, and broken world of ours. You are our only hope and the one who holds the future for all of us. Lord, may you look upon those whose names listed in our prayer request. Help them fully recover and rediscover not just their normal health, but also their faith and love for you. O Lord, use us as your church in offering comfort and peace to those who are grieving for losing their loved ones in the battle against this illness, or even those who died due to other causes. O God, we also bring before you in prayer this university, the administration, faculty, staff, and the students. May your blessings and guidance be always upon them as they deliver every task entrusted to them. In this trying moment, may you help us to see the good in each day. Help us to find reasons to rejoice and ways to be glad. Litter our lives with moments of laughter and lightheartedness. even in these extremely dark and trying times. Bless both teachers and students as they continue to struggle with their online distance learning. Remind them, O God, that each of them is created with a specific purpose. Bless the teachers as they were meant to teach, educate, coach, counsel, and lead their students. May you remind them always that they are needed, appreciated, valued, and loved, that their works are never in vain. We pray, O Lord, for blessing for all the students and their families. May you supply all their needs, especially in this time. O God, may you sustain us through our very fear of what is and will happen in our world. Remind us that we are not alone. Bind us together, O God, always in the cord of love and common witness to your truth, to your love and the gospel of life. Let this time be an opportunity for us to encounter you. O Lord, for all the concerns that you have lifted before you tonight, together with the prayers of your children and even the silent prayers of our hearts, we bring them before you. In the name of Jesus the Christ, Amen.
Reverence of the reading of God's word, please rise as we hear from the Gospel of John chapter 21 verses 15 to 19 and the first letter of John chapter 4 verses 19 to 21. And I shall be reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Let us all together read God's word. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than this?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." Now in the first letter of John, chapter 4, verses 19 to 21, the word of the Lord says, "We love because he first loved us. Those who say, 'I love God,' and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have not seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also." This is the word of the Lord. We give thanks to him. You may now be seated.
It is natural to love them that love us, but it is supernatural to love them that hate us. Good evening once again. I guess we can still feel the atmosphere of love around us as we have just celebrated Valentine's Day last Monday. But just like any other occasions, it is my prayer that may we celebrate Love Day every day, not just on Valentine's Day. Just come to think of it, if we live one day without love, what would this world be without love? What is love then that it becomes so important to every human being? While we think of love as an emotion or feeling, I would like to focus our reflection tonight on the kind of love that is manifested by our God through His Son, Jesus Christ. In the Bible, there are four types of love. Storge, which means empathy empathy bond. It is liking someone through the fondness or of familiarity, family members, or people who relate in familiar ways that have otherwise found themselves bonded by chance. Then second is philios, which is a friend bond. It is the love between friends, as close as siblings in strength and duration. Then we have eros, a romantic love. It is the love that is being felt with an opposite sex. And finally, the agape, the unconditional, enduring, perfect love of God. It is the love that exists regardless of the changing circumstances. This is the highest type of love among the four. It is the kind of love that I would like to emphasize in tonight's reflection. Agape is the kind of love that is an act of self-sacrifice. There is no such thing as agape without action. There is no such thing as agape as a feeling or as an emotion or as a sensation. It is an action. This is the kind of love that is being referred to in our passage tonight. Why did Jesus ask Peter the same question three times? I think Jesus wanted Peter to understand, and He wanted us to understand as well, that it is not enough to say, "I love you." Jesus knew Peter's personality, impulsive, aggressive, and temperamental. And having known Peter's characteristic, this time, Jesus wants to make sure whether Peter was sincere with his claim or not. It can be noted, though, that through this conversation, Jesus wants to tell us, as He tells Peter, what does it take to love Him. Jesus is telling us here the elements of loving our Lord, and that love here means the willingness to identify ourselves with our beloved. And this is clearly stated in our second passage for tonight. We love because God first loved us. The love that we have comes from God. And to show this love is not only by merely saying it, it needs action. Tonight, Jesus is showing us what does it take for us to love Him. Our love for God takes action. And let me share with you these few reflections. First, our love for God takes action to empty ourselves before God. Emptying ourselves is letting go of what is holding us in our life. It means letting go of what we hold precious in our life. And to love God is not merely saying, "Yes, Lord, I love you." Instead, it is emptying ourselves, letting go of our selfish desires, of those we want in life for the sake of ourselves. It is shifting our focus from laboring hard for the love of this world to offering our life to participate in establishing God's realm here on earth. Loving God is embarking from selfishness to selflessness. This is what God demonstrated to us when He incarnated Himself in Jesus Christ. God sending His only Son is the exemplary demonstration of how self-sacrifice is. And because of His great love for us, He emptied Himself. He gave up His own Son for us to be reconciled to Him. Loving God is letting go of those past experiences that we keep holding on. We cannot love Jesus if our heart is full of pain and hatred. We cannot love our Lord if there is hurt within us. And this is what happened to Peter. Probably because of what he did to Jesus, denying him 3 times, there is brokenness within him. For 3 times, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" To which Peter has the same response, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus knew that Peter was broken. Jesus knew that Peter needed him to graciously reach out to him. Jesus knew that he needs to restore Peter, to forgive him, to free him from his past, and to make him whole and new again. By asking Peter, "Do you love me more than this?" Jesus is not inviting Peter to compare his love to that of others. Rather, he invites Peter to realize the weakness of his own love. He invites Peter to move from a place of pride to a place of humility. For it is only from that place where Peter is able to restore his relationship with Jesus. In the same way, if we say we love God, we need to let go of our own selfish and human desires, greed, pride, arrogance. We need to let go of our past experiences that hinder us to feel and experience the grace and love of our God. We need to be freed from whatever things that prevent us to love God and let the fruit of the Holy Spirit work in our lives. We need to let go of our selfish priorities in life and let God's will be manifested in us. If we are able to let go of that to which we cling on, then we will free ourselves up to receive the real deal, God's love and the life that we are called to live, a life living no longer for ourselves, but for others. This is Peter's story of reconciliation with God. We too have our own stories to tell, like that of Peter. We may be broken, hurt, or in pain. We might have denied Jesus several times, but God offers His love, His mercy and grace to all of us. Like Peter, we just have to let go of those hindrances that we will be able to feel God reaching out to us, to pick us up, to clean us, and to empower us. Second, our love for God takes action to open up ourselves before God. Opening up ourselves up before God means listening to His voice, discerning His will, and obeying His command. This is true as it is presented in the passage in the verses prior to what we have read. Verses 4 to 6 say, "Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the beach. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, 'Children, have you any fish?' They answered him, 'No.' He said to them, 'Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some.' So they cast it out, and now they were not able to haul it in for the quantity of fish." Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the sea, fishing, but caught nothing. But when Jesus commanded them to cast their nets on the opposite side, they were amazed of their huge catch. Oftentimes in our lives, we tend to follow our own will, following our own plans. Too often we rely on our own efforts alone, which sometimes results into nothing and barrenness. But this story somehow taught us a lesson that when we have exhausted everything in order to get things done, yet it still yields nothing, we need to listen to God. Listening to God's voice is a result of knowing Him, for we cannot listen to someone if we do not know such person. Of course, we can hear anybody, but we only listen to someone we know, especially when it has to do something with our life. When we know who the voice is, we'll listen attentively to it. Listening is different from hearing. We listen to understand and then to make action. Knowing and listening to God doesn't mean much if there is no obedience. Again, it needs action. We need to do what God commanded us to. But many of us usually wonder if what they hear is really from God. And this keeps us from taking action. The fear of being wrong prevents us from ever having the opportunity to be right. Remember, God looks at the heart. When He sees us stepping out in faith, even if we are heading in the wrong direction, He can lovingly correct us, pointing us to the right direction and redirecting our path towards the way He wants us to follow. Through a pattern of obedience, we begin to develop a confidence and assurance that we really have heard from God. How do we know that it is God leading us? We will know it because it leads us toward the path of righteousness. We need to be reminded that God's ways are always better and sure. Had the disciples refused to listen to Jesus' voice and command, they would have caught nothing. But they did. As Rick Warren reminds us when he says, "You cannot fulfill God's purposes for your life while focusing on your own plans." Let us open ourselves up before God, then listen to His voice and obey His command if we are to love God. Finally, our love for God takes action to serve Him by sharing and caring for others. We are challenged to put our love for God into action because God's love, again, is not a feeling or an emotion. It is an action. Love is never idle. This is how Jesus demonstrated to us. Jesus' love was manifested in everything that He did to the people, showing compassion, feeding, healing, teaching. This is probably the reason why Jesus had to ask Peter for 3 times. Jesus wants to know the sincerity and the depth of Peter's love towards Him. Jesus wants to make sure that Peter's love will not only be expressed in word, as most of us do. Jesus wants Peter to realize that the kind of love that he wants is needs concrete action. Jesus could have told Peter, "Do not just say it, do it." And he commanded Peter to take care of his sheep. Loving Christ means partaking of his work, taking part of his role as a shepherd. A shepherd has to take care of his sheep, feeding and tending them. And to love Christ is to share what we have in life and to care those who are in need. That is to help them meet their needs. Our love for Jesus is best expressed in loving and caring for others. Love will make sense only when we give ourselves in the service of the Lord through others. Our love for Christ requires service. And this is clearly emphasized by Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, when he says, "Just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." This is what Jesus is trying to make Peter understand, that loving him means doing what he does. To love Christ is to serve Him through others. It means meeting the need of others, especially the needy. For service to others is service to Christ. Again, this is what Jesus meant in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, verses 35 to 40, saying, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you come to me. Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me. Our love for God entails self-sacrifice, and it becomes our inspiration, our motivation to serve others. That is why Jesus asked Peter first, "Do you love me?" before commanding him to feed his sheep. Why did Christ do that? Because we cannot love or take care of others without loving Christ first. For our love for others is coming only from our Lord, not from our own love or strength. For wherever there is a need, we should ask God to lead us to it and help us to meet such need as if we are meeting Christ. Serving and caring for others could be our best expression of loving Christ. There are many ways we can do this, as students, as teachers, as parents, as young people. Our country is suffering from a series of calamities. Many are suffering. Many are in need. And each of us can do our share. There is no small amount of help for people who are in dire need. And remember, when we are meeting these needs, we are also meeting Christ. God's greatest manifestation of His love to the world is self-sacrifice by sending His own Son to redeem us. That is how broad and wide and deep God's love for us all. So, what does it take for us to love God? It takes for us to act out our love for God, for love itself is action. Let us spread our love for God and fill this world with love as we serve God by sharing and caring for others. God bless us all. Amen.
As we have been directed to pray in secret, so too we are invited to give without letting the right hand know what the left hand is doing. When we bring an offering, we are responding to God's generosity, not trying to impress our neighbors. Our tithes already belong to God. Our extra gifts are treasures laid up in heaven. Let us now translate our love into action as we respond to God's challenge before us. O God, we have heard. Your presence has moved us to respond. Send us where you want us to go. Use the resources we dedicate here to empower others to witness to your love and care. Fill our lives with thanksgiving. Fill our days with purpose. We rededicate ourselves to work and worship that express our profound gratitude for life and all its opportunities. Amen.
At this moment in our worship, we offer these Bibles to be given to the confirmants, which we will accept through our virtual worship service this Sunday. As we now offer before the Lord these Bibles, God's gift for his people, so that the story of God and God's people may be us in our home, church, or in workplace, our prayer that God's word and his story of redemption through love will echo in the lives of his children through all generations. In the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we shall all journey together to continue learning the teachings of Jesus. Make our hearts, O God, be open to heeding to your word and enable the hearts of those who will receive these Bibles to love and meditate it night and day, so they will grow in the stature and knowledge of Jesus, our Savior. Let us pray. Blessed be him, O Lord, our God. You are the fount and source of every blessing. You have revealed yourself to your human creation in many and diverse ways. Our memory of your revelation is maintained and revered in the scriptures that we hold in our hands. Look with delight upon us today as we renew our commitment to share the gospel and remember you in the stories of our salvation. Help us to absorb its wisdom and live its inspired truth. Encourage us with the help of the Holy Spirit to use these sacred writings for our prayer, inspiration, living our faith, for the increase of our faith and devotion, and for the building up of your kingdom. Through your word, may we be transformed into the very likeness of Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, now and always. Amen.
Stay.
Let us pray. O Lord our God, indeed tonight our spirits are lifted and full of hope because of your abounding love for us, shown to us every day and in many ways. May this worship be a reminder to us, O Lord, that you have called us with a purpose to love, to take care, and tend your people. Dear God, we praise and thank you for your holy presence, your inspiration and guidance in our worship celebration tonight. Thank you for your perfect love that inspires and challenges our faith. Thank you for your perfect love that casts out all our fears and strengthens us as we face the challenges of life. May the good words we learn tonight guide us as we continue living our lives with purpose. Help us to love you more, O God, by loving the people whom you entrusted to us. May we be your instrument of love to those who need your love and care. Lord God, tonight we take this time to remember and pray for those who are lonely, ill, and suffering. May you touch them with your comfort and heal them with your healing hands. We pray for wisdom, strength, and guidance for your people, and for the many concerns known to you, O Lord. Please guide us and strengthen us. Holy Spirit, and hear our prayers, dear God. We ask this in the name of Jesus. And now, people of God, go in peace. As you go out into the world, seek the presence of Christ in each other and in all creation. May God give you joyful courage to follow the command of Jesus. Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Just as I am, you welcome me. With open arms, how can this be?
My guilt is undone, my past is untethered. I leave it behind and run to my Father. There's no disappointment in your eyes. There is no shame, there is only pride. I am loved, Father, I'm loved by you.
For me,
my fear is gone, I am set free.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's nothing to hide, there's nothing to measure. 'Cause I am your child, and that's all that matters. There's no disappointment in your eyes. There's no shame, there is only pride.
Changing everything.
I love.